Penguin Random House Audio presents How to Be a Person in the World, Ask Polly's Guide Through the Paradoxes of Modern Life. This is the author, Heather Havrilesky. Author's Note. In the fall of 2012, I pitched an existential advice column to The All, a website that publishes smart original takes on modern culture. At the time, I was a regular contributor to New York Times Magazine, writing mostly essays about pop culture, and I had a column called The Bestseller List in Book Forum. I'd spent 7 years as a TV critic for Salon.com. I'd written a cartoon called Filler for Suck.com, the internet's first daily website, for 5 years before that, and I'd answered advice letters on my own blog as early as 2001. But this was something new. I'd never dished up advice to a wider audience. When The All's co-founder, Corey Sika, said yes to my idea, he made it clear that the column could be anything I wanted it to be. But what did I want it to be? Obviously, I had all kinds of outspoken, sometimes unwelcome, advice to offer friends, family, and complete strangers alike. I'd been handing out unsolicited advice for years. But did I want the column to be funny? Did I want to use the column to rail against the scourge of passivity and avoidance in modern relationships, or to address our culture's burdensome fixation on constant self-improvement? Did I want to sneak in some commentary on troubled friendships, Kanye West, weddings, rescue dogs, Lux brands, commitment-phobic men, property ownership, the artist's life, pushy mothers-in-law, or Game of Thrones? As it turned out, I wanted to do all of these things, and eventually I did. But when I was sitting down to write my first weekly column, I just felt scared. Who do I think I am giving other people advice? I thought. I'm not qualified for this. I don't have it all figured out. What the hell am I doing? I've been asking myself that same question every week for 4 years now. And when Stella Bugbee, the editorial director for New York Magazine's website, The Cut, approached me about taking my advice column over to her site, I wondered what she was thinking. Sure, this meant a much larger audience for Ask Polly and more money for me, but did she really know what she was signing on to? You know my column is 3,000 words long every week, and half of those words are fuck, right? I asked her. Somehow, this didn't scare her off. I don't always feel qualified to guide other people to a better life. As a writer, even when I'm sitting down to start a book review or a cultural essay, as I've done professionally for years now, the blank page mocks me. What could you possibly have to say? It asks. When are you going to give this up and do something useful with your life? The blank page can be a real asshole sometimes. Still, nothing I do brings me more happiness than writing Ask Polly. I'm not always sure of the right answer for any letter, whether someone is dealing with depression and anxiety, a go-nowhere job, a series of not-quite boyfriends, or an overly critical parent. But I do know for certain that when I reach out as far as I can to another person using my words, my awkward, angry, uplifting, uncertain, joyful, clumsy words, half of which are still fuck, some kind of magic happens. There is magic that comes from reaching out. I don't believe in many things, but I believe in that with all of my heart. Part 1. Flaws become you. Here comes the anxious bride. Dear Polly, I am getting married in June, and I am the first child in my family to be getting married. I have a younger brother and a younger sister, both of whom I'm very close with. Throughout the wedding planning process, I have tried to be very non-dramatic and very non-bridezilla-y, but when my sister, also my maid of honor, recently asked if she could bring her foreign boyfriend to meet my parents for the first time and also attend the wedding, I immediately and adamantly refused her. My sister, since entering college, has far and away been considered the hot sister. When we are together, other people, including our own relatives and family friends, often mistake her for the older sister because she looks more mature and sophisticated. Not only is she a talented amateur photographer, but she also spent a gap year in Europe and is now trilingual. She also managed to get into the Ivy League that my parents wish I had gotten into and enjoys the kind of popularity I have never experienced in my life, nor will I ever experience. I, on the other hand, could aptly be considered the nerdy sister, who was smart and always did things the right way, but will never be glamorous or nearly as interesting. We were never that competitive as children, because our age gap made a big difference then. But now I have absurd conniptions of jealousy whenever my sister posts gorgeous pictures from her parties and travels. When my sister was in Europe last year, she acquired a very attractive older foreign boyfriend. No one in my family was convinced it would last. But now, they are still together and seem pretty serious. My sister skipped Christmas to spend it abroad with him. Now she suddenly wants him to meet all of us in the States, and she wants it to happen my wedding weekend. When I think about this happening, my head implodes because I know all our relatives and mutual friends will be stunned by how gorgeous she and her perfect boyfriend look together. Because she has never introduced him to anyone, this will mean extra excitement that will almost certainly steal the spotlight from my wedding, my party, which I want to be about me. I know this all sounds petty and selfish, but if there's ever a time in your life you get to be a little bit selfish, it's at your own goddamn wedding. And I just can't shake the idea that if I let her bring him, their stupid perfect luminosity will overshadow everything else. I also know that my refusal is almost entirely due to my own insecurities. But you only get married once. Her boyfriend can meet everyone at another time, right? Am I being insanely mean for not letting him come to the wedding? Is it okay for me to be selfish this time? Or will I regret this later? Selfish bride. Dear selfish bride, yes, you can be selfish at your own goddamn wedding. You can invite anyone you want and wear anything you want and serve exactly what you love to eat. Hell, if you wanted to, you could release 21 white doves and then shoot them all out of the sky with a shotgun, one by one. Fuck it. It's your day to be the most beautiful fairy princess in the whole universe. It's your day to shine. And let's just admit it. No matter how much we try to rise above it, most of us do have this strange little desire to be the most glamorous creature on the face of the planet for just one day. One goddamn day. That's all we ask. Can you really blame us? Did we not grow up in this idiotic, airbrushed, lip-glossy, goddess-adoring culture? How many Disney movies and beauty pageants and episodes of The Bachelor can you watch before some sick corner of your brain calcifies into an absurd desire to be a gorgeous, shiny, sparkle princess for just one day? Here's the awful truth, though. Some of us just aren't any good at pulling off the sparkle princess thing. We can't manage it. Sure, if we were surrounded by a team of expensive stylists and trainers and nutritionists and managers and fluffers at all times, we might be able to do it. If we had highly paid service professionals who handed us tall glasses of iced lemon water and fluffed our hair and rubbed pig fetuses into our crow's feet every few milliseconds, then we might pull off something faintly approximating glamour and poise and glittery perfection. But on your wedding day, instead of being surrounded by fawning helper types, you're going to find yourself surrounded by your family. Your family, for fuck's sake. Not to mention your self-involved bitch-ass friends. And even though your friends are so supportive and loving that they'll volunteer to help make sure you don't get a terrible updo from the hairstylist, who will look just like Dolly Parton, by the way, instead, they're going to take off to have lunch and leave you alone, and your hair is going to get uglier and uglier with all these curly tendrils forming like you're an early 80s Olympic figure skater. But you're going to be so hungry and nervous and unhinged that you won't say a word, You'll just start weeping and snotting into your hands, and your $150 makeup job will smear, but you won't be able to stop crying, and you'll text your friends, "Help!" And they'll say, "Back in a sec." But they won't be back until 30 minutes later, and by then you'll look like Hermione Granger at the Yule Ball.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.